Thank you all for joining today in this remote leadership workshop that we're putting on today. So just to give you an idea of what we're going to go through today. First, we're going to go through to do introductions where we actually did that more or less already now. I think we kind of all know each other. But I'll just take a second in a minute to introduce myself. And then I want to start with a brief reflection on the challenges and opportunities that you and many others are probably facing at the moment as a result of remote team working. Then I want to look at leadership concepts briefly and then see how they can be applied, or rather how the best ones can be applied in today's day in life. Then I want to go through like a little best practice guide on what makes a really good remote team leader in today's day and age. Then with that, I want to look at how to best manage online meetings, because obviously that's the main focus point of remote team working. That's where everyone gathers together. And then I want to introduce you to some online tools that you can use for your remote teamwork. And finally, I want to go through what happens when performance drops. I did say this was recorded, but you're welcome to basically interrupt me at any one point and ask questions, and then we can cut you out if you don't want to be in. And so, first, I want to take a minute to introduce ourselves. I think we kind of more or less did that, but just in case you don't know me, I'm Julia. I'm a 23-year-old PhD candidate in psycholinguistics, and I'm from Germany. Does anybody else want to kind of quickly chime in again, or are you all good?
I mean, I can chime in, sir. I'm eating pizza. But you all know me. You all know me. Now, obviously, I know you, Krishna, obviously, we've been emailing each other back and forth. You've been attending the Essex Startups events. I know your face is very familiar as well now, after a number of them. But yeah, obviously, I'm an enterprise assistant for Essex Startups. So I help out, pretty much do the dirty work for them, running events, answering emails, scheduling everything. Doing, as I like to put it, the heavy lifting, once they come up with more ideas on how they can make me do more. But it's an exciting job, I love it. And apart from that, I run a graphics design business whilst working on other ideas, so it's pretty neat from my perspective.
Thank you.
I'll pop in and say hi as well. So like Christian, I've just been eating my dinner. Sorry, Julia. It's just the time of day. We can all get hungry. I'm Daisy. I'm a first year law student, but I was at the uni doing a foundation year last year. I used to work in insurance, and I got chosen to be president of the Essex Entrepreneurs Society. And I'm part of a co-founding team. So we set this all up this year, and we're having a very good time, and our events are going well so far. So yeah, feel free to get in touch at any point if anybody needs something. And it's lovely to see some new faces and familiar faces.
Thank you.
So
the first thing that I want to do with you tonight is introduce you to the VBox app. It's an audience engagement tool. And basically how you get on it is either through your phone by typing in vbox.app in your browser. You can also download the app, but this is an option where you don't need to download the app, which I'm very, very thankful about, because I hate downloading apps for every single thing. And then if you type in the ID that is down here, you'll be able to take part in the following questions. Maybe give me a hands up also when you're done with that, then I can go on. Okay,
Daisy. Yeah, give me a moment. So we're downloading the VVox. Yep.
No, you don't have to download the app. You can just type in the browser, or even go, so on the computer or your phone, you go on the VVox app, also VVox.app, and it's a web app.
Very excited to be asked to take part in something. It immediately makes you go, yes, I want to do this. What are the questions?
Exactly. That's why kind of using audience engagement in your presentation is something very useful. So the first question that I want to ask today is, what are the benefits you get from working remotely? That's basically, you can just for now put in some, I don't know, keywords or so. I think anyway, the limit is 20 words. So yeah. And you can basically type in one word and then press enter and type more words if you want, if you feel like it. Okay, here we are. So firstly, check out how amazing this visualization tool is. Secondly, we have, for the actual content, we have pajamas. Yes, very, very true. With many interaction with, okay, probably that's a bit of a fault of the system. You can get lots of interactions. In fact, it's actually so easy to collaborate across the entire world now. I mean, the fact that Krishna now is joining us from India, that wasn't able, and that we weren't able to do before. Food means you can work at flexible hours. That's something that we didn't have before. Pajamas, I completely feel you. I'm sitting in pajamas right now. It's so much more comfy. Yeah, and yeah, comfort. And yeah, a variety of things can be done digitally that couldn't be done online. At the moment, it's just a matter of kind of getting used to them. And that brings me to what are the challenges you face at the moment as a result of remote teamwork. And I've just opened the polls again for you now. And we have here compatibility, network, no fun, tools, and no socializing. What do you mean with compatibility?
Oh, that's tech compatibility. Some of them are not browser friendly, some of them are not mobile friendly. So the interface, you know, certain things do not support certain, you know, apps or utilities or certain functionalities.
You mean for developing now?
No, say for example, when we are digitally networking, Zoom probably does not work on, say, you know, some Android phones, Nokia or some models. So that kind of issues in terms of compatibility, tech compatibility.
Damn, that's something I wasn't even prepared for. Okay. Then we have the network. The network also, yeah, terrible. No fun. Why is it not fun? We will go into some things that will hopefully make remote networking more fun. Also tools, conflict is a big thing. No socializing again. Why not socializing? We will go into that again also. Some things that you haven't mentioned here is that people might feel isolated. They're missing maybe the facial expressions and the body language that we often have. And that also kind of creates conflict that sometimes you wouldn't have if you kind of saw the people in person. And people may feel overwhelmed with technical aspects, I guess, especially when compatibility isn't working, but also if you're getting introduced to a new tool that you haven't been working with before, that can be quite overwhelming, for instance, for Christian. Okay, and now the question is, now that we've kind of put the challenges before us, how can team leaders overcome these challenges? And I want to start here first with kind of like the most extreme cases. So the dichotomy of leadership, the theory of X and Y. So in the theory of X, the leader thinks that he has to control every single thing you do and thinks that you're a lazy piece of poop who won't do anything if they don't keep an eye on you. On contrast, there's the theory Y leader who trusts you completely that you will do everything because you're an intrinsically motivated human who is just perfect and will get all of the work done. And he himself is right now on his chicken floaty somewhere off in Greece and is gonna be like, yeah, it's gonna be fine. But even without a pandemic, you'll see that obviously people are kind of somewhat in between. We need to kind of have some control and some trust. And people will feel stressed and definitely not enjoy working with you if you're kind of controlling them all the time. And in the same way, if you become too lenient, they might go off and do whatever, but not the thing that you want them to do. So what does a perfect leader look like at the moment? And I like to go back to this picture here and say, for instance, now, can you actually see my cursor? I don't know. This person is Tom, and what he's done here is that he has perfectly organized his team and executed something really, really successful. In this case, he said to, I don't know, his teammates, say Lindsay, hey Lindsay and everyone else, I have this amazing idea. Let's jump out of a plane. Let's make it a really pretty shape. It's going to look amazing. We're all going to be part in it. Everyone needs to be there. It doesn't work if one of them is missing. So really chime in and do this with me. It's going to be amazing. And what he also did was that he did trust several members to kind of know what they were doing, but he also kind of made sure that before they did it, they all took their parachute with them, because else the consequences could have been quite fatal. And what Tom did was very nice in this way. He trusted the people, but not too much. And he also put forward a shared vision and motivated the people to do this. And in the end, they were able to execute this really amazing thing. And so what this is called is transformational leadership. Transformational leadership is not so much, it is a middle thing between this trusty and controlling kind of relationship. So it's it should be kind of like a perfect balance, but you're also kind of changing the behavior of people. So what you're doing is to change the negative perception of a team or kind of a team member toward the teamwork to a positive one. And you do that by sharing a common vision, by motivating them, having trust in you, and making them feel like they're part of the team. And now I put this heading there, become transformational. And now you say, yeah, okay, Julia, this sounds all very inspiring and so, but how do we do that? And then I say, oh, this is very easy. You just take that minus and put a little stroke in there and it becomes a positive. No. So in what follows, I want to kind of quickly go through the best practice of exactly how you can transform this behavior of your team to become positive, to have a positive perception of your teamwork, and get them more motivated in this teamwork. So first of all, what is very important is that you lay out a roadmap, so that people kind of see where you want to go and what your ultimate goal is. So for instance, here, it would be world domination. Perhaps not so admirable, but yeah. And what you then want to do is that you have different steps along the way that you can work toward, and that then also you celebrate the success when different milestones are reached, so that people have an idea that they're kind of on a road, on a journey. Then the second important, very important step is that, well, actually many important steps, is that you outline the small steps that need to be taken to achieve this goal. So you can't just say, okay, yeah, we'll have this and then, yeah, we somehow manage it or so. But you have to be very, very clear on what needs to be done and who needs to do it. And this means that we have to make sure that everyone is involved and understands what they're doing, and also that they're part of something bigger. We have to also make sure that they know what they're doing. Did I say that already? I think so. We need to set deadlines if need be, because sometimes we need to recognize that certain things build up on others. So Tom can't send out invitations if he doesn't know the venue from Luis. And that all sounds easy enough, but if you fail to outline these little steps, the consequences may be quite tough. People may feel overwhelmed and they don't know kind of what to do, and then they are a bit too awkward to ask. They might not feel like they're part, and then they can feel ostracized. People might do something that you actually don't want them to be doing, and that creates friction. And also outlining these steps will also make you realize that if you forget something, you will kind of know about that before and not on the day. And so on the day, if you're missing the beer, if you had outlined the simple steps, it wouldn't be missing and you wouldn't make the German very, very unhappy. Very important, C stands for communication. Communicate as much as possible. You can't take any decisions without the team, because that will ultimately make others feel less valued or kind of not part of it. And you have to make sure that everyone knows what's going on. And for bigger organizations or bigger teams, I actually encourage the use of visualization processes or process visualization. But I guess visualization processes are part of process visualization. This helps to exactly communicate the little steps that people need to take. So for instance, in our entrepreneur society, the way we do it in order to host an event is that we first have an idea and then write it down. Then we will share this idea with our team. And then if they really like it, we can move on. But if they don't like it, we need to revise and resubmit it. Then, so if they like it, then we find and communicate a date and time for the event. And again, if they like it, then great. If they don't like it, we revise and resubmit. And if that is then cool, we can send a ticket to social media, and I'll show you in a second how we do that. And then you can either, social media will send you a little draft of their poster, and then you can say, yes, I want that, or no, you'll have to do it again. And then you can host the event. And then again, if you have like lots of these different processes, it also, and people kind of rely on you, you have to set different deadlines. So for instance, this social media ticket cannot be sent later than a week before the event, so as to give the social media person enough time to do it. And this may sound a bit, yeah, maybe a bit too much or so, but for bigger organizations or very efficient teams, this really helps. And this helps people understand what they're doing. It is previously agreed. It shouldn't be overwhelming. And also they don't need to ask 1,000 times, because it clearly is outlined in this visualization. Then, in the same way that you need to clearly communicate to your team what you want of them, it is also very, very important that you listen and ask about how your team is doing. And that means that you kind of do need to take the time and ask, yeah, is everything okay with you, also privately and also with your work. They might go through some really rough stuff, especially now in the pandemic, and you really need to make sure that you acknowledge that and empathize, and then also ultimately accommodate these needs in your team. And if they don't feel like the stuff is working for them, you need to give a space to let them speak out and then work with that. But I'll come to that also again later. Speaking of accommodation, there is something called situational leadership. And this hopefully will help you see how to accommodate different needs. So the idea here is that different people have different degrees of competency or commitment. And I'll quickly go through those. So if your person has low competency but high commitment, you probably want to kind of be more telling toward them and kind of more tell them in which direction they need to go to, because they're full of energy and want to do stuff, but they don't actually know how to. So it really helps if you kind of outline that for them. Then if you have a person with some competency, but kind of low commitment, they can do stuff, but only if they kind of want to. And so what you need to do to them is that you need to sell the idea to them. You have to be like, oh, you know, wouldn't it be so amazing if, and in this way, then kind of fight for the commitment so as to get the work done. Then what you have is a person with high commitment, with variable commitment, but with high competency. And these are guys who usually have like tons of other stuff, and they just want to know what you need them, what you need doing, and just give it to them, and they hop off and they're happy. With these guys, you don't need to kind of sell stuff. You don't need to tell them stuff. In fact, if you tell them stuff, they might get a bit pissy. And so just if you tell them what needs doing, they're good. And then these guys, the high competency, high commitment ones, they're your favorites, because basically there you just say, yo man, I need this done. And he's like, yo man, I got you. I'm gonna give it to you by Monday morning on your desk, no problems. And yeah, so perhaps you can use this kind of little diagram to see where your teammates fit in and kind of then what their needs are in terms of your relationship with them. And if you kind of recognize a problem that perhaps one of them is not in, like if you haven't been treating them in the right group, that you kind of recognize this problem and then come up with innovative solutions together. But this is again something that I'm gonna touch on later. Then a very important point is that you build a trusting relationship with them. Sounds simple enough also, but what does it actually mean? You can't just kind of go like, oh yeah, trust me, I'm a good person. But you have to let your teammates see you for who you are. That also means that you should share what you're doing in like a safe space. Say if you're struggling or so, don't kind of play it up and say, oh no, I'm not struggling or so, but tell them how it is so that they then kind of see you as just a person, which will then also hopefully help them to empathize with you and share also what is going on with them, and also share when they're struggling with a problem.
I did want to ask a question about the situational leadership. So I think I'm treating them in the right way for what they show, but what if could you misjudge someone's competency and maybe think they're less competent than they actually are, and therefore they should be in a different box and you should treat them in a different way?
Definitely, yeah. So it will only crystallize later on, basically what their competency is. Is that already answering the question?
Any tips on measuring the competencies then?
Yes, that would be helpful.
Wow. I think just give them a task and see whether it's done or not.
Yeah, I guess.
I can share a quick experience with, one thing with the consultancy that I work with. So some of them fit right in, and I could tell from their behavior that some of them were high competency, high commitment, so you could delegate. You don't want to tell them. Just a quick summary is enough. And then you have someone who's got really good drive, very high drive, bit egoistic. They don't want to be told. So that's where participative thing come. And I have my own a long time employee, and he needs to be told exactly to the T. He does just what he's told. So that neatly fits in. And, you know, I struggle with the selling people. I usually stay away from, you know, someone who needs to be sold.
I think also it depends on kind of the different task and the different kind of team that you're working in. I feel like in some places I'm this person and another place I'm this person. So, yeah.
That's true. Like they could be competent in a different role or in a different area, doesn't mean that they're necessarily low competent, just means that they're low competent at this particular thing.
Exactly, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's also obviously not good to kind of immediately label people, but kind of like maybe getting a little feel for where they fit in or so, and then kind of working with that, and then kind of working on that kind of relationship. Okay, then I move on for now. You can also have some questions at the end. Online meetings. Obviously, as I said, kind of like the place where all of the stuff comes together. And the problem with online meetings, as opposed to normal meetings, is that because you're behind a screen in the safe comfort of your own home or so, you can get distracted so easily and nobody will kind of call you out for it. And it is actually so hard sometimes to listen to somebody go on about something that you don't care so much about, and then can't, you know, just kind of get your phone out and then do a little scrolling on Instagram or actually check the election results. I'm actually really, really excited now for the election results. Well, am I excited? I'm kind of more like, oh, I'm a bit nervous about them. No. And then food or other things, and sometimes cats come in the picture also. And what that means for you as a leader is that you kind of have to fight for the engagement or the attention of that participant. And that can sometimes be a bit quite, yeah, a bit difficult, but with the following techniques, hopefully you'll be able to kind of keep the focus a bit longer. I have this checklist for online meetings. The most important things for meeting is that you come in with a clear goal. And most of the time I actually recommend that you come in with an agenda. So I've been doing that recently for a couple of my meetings where I got the points out that I kind of prepared just before, or kind of whenever I needed to ask a question to that particular person, I kind of write it down and then put it in the agenda just so that I wouldn't forget afterward. And also what is very, very important is that you have the required sheets open. If you are a person who kind of gets into a meeting, and if you're leading the meeting and then the person just goes like, okay, so let me just get that document out for you. And this goes on for like 30 seconds, the participant is gonna go off, like they're gonna, I don't know, find a pencil to play with or so, but they're not gonna listen to you anymore. So you're gonna do yourself such a big favor if you already have the sheets open that you need. Then sometimes it's good to agree on some rules if need be. So one of the rules that I actually really like in some of my meetings is that you raise your hand before you want to speak to facilitate turn taking. Apparently, when you're in a smaller team, people think that's a bit silly. So perhaps for some meetings you want to agree on some rules, and some other meetings maybe you kind of rather agree on getting rid of some rules instead. Another idea for rules could be that you put your video on, because it's actually so much more easier for the leader if you have your video on, because that actually then shows that you're kind of actively paying attention, but that then shows the leader that you're actively listening also, and also kind of give some feedback to the leader. Because if I see now that somebody is kind of like just going off, like maybe like a bit jittery or so, then I would ask, yeah, how is the jittery? So is there something wrong? Or if they're kind of about to sleep, then I know, okay, I guess I better move on with the next slide or so. And it also helps, especially in the team, we talked earlier about body language and kind of facial expression feedback, that because we don't have that, that creates conflict. Well, there are means kind of to turn on the video so that then that problem can be overcome. But it is obviously very easy. And I also do that sometimes, that I just kind of turn my video off. And then sometimes do other things. But yeah, One thing that is really cool is if you use digital tools. We used VBox, but in a minute I'm going to show you Trello and Miro as well. And this is very useful because earlier we had it, you were asked something and you're like, yeah, I can take part in something. And that kind of is then more interactive. You don't feel like you're just like being told something as in a lecture, but you're being involved and you're actively concentrating on something. So that is really good. You also really have to begin in a positive tone. I'm sure you've come into meetings where people are kind of like, how good are you also? But it's really good if you come in with energy, because then people really wanna be there. They're really happy to be there and they really like you and they kind of feed off your energy, even if it's kind of just staged, I guess. And also, well, this brings us back to the rules. Make sure that everyone's present. As I said before, some people kind of like might go off or they kind of feel bored or so. And the video really helps there kind of to get the feedback in. At the end of the meeting, it is very important that you kind of end with some takeaway message so that people don't feel like the meeting has been for nothing. Because that then means that they are clearly not so motivated in the next meeting. So if you kind of just discuss the results of the meeting and then maybe follow up with the to-dos that need to be doing for the next meeting, that is really, really helpful. So that is my checklist. And now for the online tools I promised you. Here I have a screenshot, not of my own, but of a Trello that I found online. I was a bit shy to share my own Trello. But in fact, I have actually now made sure that it's nothing embarrassing on it. And here I have all of the tabs that I need for the different jobs that I'm doing. And I put all of them here. So these are little cards that you can add. And here I can say, I don't know, sleep. And that is then a to-do. And then when a to-do is done, I can get rid of that. And so this is basically like an online to-do list. But what's very cool about it is that I can actually invite others to also join this. And they can then also give little cards to the different things that need to be done. And so you basically have also a kind of process visualization of the things that need to be doing. If you want, I can show trade. Cool. Actually, Christian, you want to showcase your Trello?
Yeah, let me just check whether there isn't any sensitive information on it. And then I'm going to share my screen with you. Because let me see. Because I've got a very, very interesting way, the way that I laid mine out. I had a look at your one. And Trello is really good. But I think if you use it in a way that works for you, it's 100 times better. I'm going to show it to you in a second. Let me just see, include, blah, 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 blah.
What's really cool with Trello is obviously you can use it kind of like how you want it. So another method is kind of what I just showed in the PowerPoint with like a backlog, then to do, doing, done. That's a Kanban method, and that's quite popular. I use it with my startup. And then I like to kind of put it all in the different jobs that I'm doing. And what I also really like about this is we have a Trello for the Entrepreneur Society where we kind of put the tasks in the different for the different people, because anyway, we all do kind of like different stuff. We all have different jobs. And what I really like about this is that I can synchronize my Entrepreneur Society Trello cards with my personal one, such that they then show up in my personal Trello. And I don't need to go back and forth. Christian, are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. And I'm going to show you something that could drastically transform your life. So pay attention. Let me just see, that's screen number 3, share. I hope what you can see is my Trello board, right? Hope. Is this, can you see the Trello board?
Yeah.
Don't worry about individual items, please. You know, but essentially the way that it works, if you want to organize stuff, I use one of two things in order to organize my day. So sort of to give a quick lecture on organization, but I worked in, having worked in conference production where you like create events and you work on several projects simultaneously and all of them spam you with loads of different things to do. Like I know a bit about it. My first one is just have a to-do list and box away the different times that you have in your day. Just write it out from like 9 a.m. to however long you want to work, however long you want to make your day's worth of work, and box it out half an hour, 15 minutes, and organize and fill in essentially from your to-do list. Fill that in. Just anything that you have in your to-do list, you put it on your to-do, and then throughout your day, that means you stick to specific tasks and you allocate them individual time slots. Because we all know when we get on with something, like let's say if you need to answer your emails, we all have been there, we can like spend like a whole day answering emails and then you don't even go through half of them. But if you put that deadline and you put that fire underneath yourself where you go, I only have like an hour to answer as many emails as possible, that helps you get stuff done. That instantly works. In terms of the Trello, that's a second way of organizing it. What I like to do is I like to place all my to-dos on Trello, and then I transport anything from my Trello onto that. And Trello just helps me essentially update my team in terms of what I'm doing, what projects I'm working on, or what projects I have worked on. It is a bad idea to have like to separate it, I think, to separate your to-dos, but I do it this way. It works for me. But the way that you should try doing it, if any of you wants to try it, have a general to-do. If you're working on a lot of projects, anything that you need to do, place in your to-do. That's like literally like your forever, like whatever ideas you have, whatever you need to have done, obviously place in your to-do. Whatever you want to get done today, in the beginning of the day, place it in your today tab. Place it here. So for example, if I want to search for leads for like a business, I want to update the webinar descriptions, what else can I get today? Maybe I can get the startups inbox done for my workplace. Maybe I could get one of my clients like a hoodie and a phone case. I'll place that in the to-do for today. So the things that I need to get done today. Once I get them done, put them in the done column. So in the end of the day, you have a clear perspective on what you've done. If that creates new to-dos, place them in here and just keep on doing it. Does that make sense? It's a very simple design, but it works so well, I find it, because I fall into a trap where if I just have a to-do and I don't allocate myself a specific time or a date to do it, then it will just sit there in my to-do because there will always be something else that will push it over in priority. And sometimes the projects just sit there and it's the most annoying thing in the world for that to happen.
Yeah, I also do it the same way in terms of self-management, that I put, so I book a calendar, and anyway, it synchronizes with all of the stuff that I do at university. And I also put off my societies in there. And then any time that I still have free, I put a little kind of box there that says to-do time. And in this time, I basically have Trello's. And if I have like a specific deadline, then I make sure that I put that there. So for instance, yesterday I put the entire day work on this presentation. One thing that I also want to kind of point out is that obviously with Trello we said that you can put the cards, as we've also seen with Christians, and here you can put pictures in. That makes it sometimes a bit more exciting, so you can personalize it in the ways that you need to do. You can also attach stuff, which is really cool. You can say who does what, which is good when you're working in the team, and actually so many other things. But let me quickly tell you about prioritizing things. So I saw Christian didn't prioritize, but instead he kind of moved things to today or not today. So today or later. One thing that I do, I guess with Essex Entrepreneur Society and my startup, and I guess also my personal life, is how I'm prioritizing according to importance and urgency. And so this is using the label system. You can see here there's different labels. So these are the little bars up here. And this is just another visualization tool to see which tasks need to be gone sooner or later. And so I label in red the bits that need to be done as soon as possible because they are really important and they have high urgency. Then come the ones that have low importance, but still need to be done as soon as possible because at one point they're gonna become high importance because you can't live without them. And so these need to be done next. Then the colors go off because yellow didn't really work anymore, are the ones that are still important, but not so urgent, and I do them after that. And then there's the ones that like I do at one point or so. And then even in purple, I have ones that I basically do when I feel like it, and they then come in purple, and they're like things like, I don't know, send a secret Santa to Daisy or so. But actually I will do that at one point. That is for now low importance, low urgency, but it will at one point become high urgency come December. This turned out very ugly on my big screen now, but I'm moving up my actual Miro up here. Miro is an online whiteboard which has many, many, many really cool visualization techniques. So how this works is basically you work on a really, really large frame with different people again, and it has stuff like, okay, so first you basically make a little A4 sheet of paper or whatever you want. And then it has these cool tools which you would basically work with if you had like a normal whiteboard, which is, oh, come on, so much for, which are, for instance, some kind of like mind maps or user stories, and or here even like weekly agendas or so. And here, 2x2 prioritization method. I should have been using that for the previous slide, I guess. But so it has all of these really cool templates already, and that will help you visualize stuff. And basically then the stuff that you can do with it is endless. There's endless possibilities. You can put pictures in, you can put text in, you can put huge ass arrows in, little stars, emojis, you can even just give it squiggles or so. You can put screenshots and you can comment on different stuff. Here's a comment, okay. And if you work in UI and UX, it's actually really cool because you also have these phone frames, so you can then put in whatever you want to have on a phone screen if you do that. If you then kind of use some of the power apps, you can also kind of do video chats or so, all in one app if you don't wanna use Zoom at the same time. But yeah, so. For some people, this is really cool. For some, maybe it doesn't make so much sense. I've seen it before in hackathons. This is amazing stuff. And also, I've seen it also for conference organizations, where they have like the different kind of like workshops also happening, and then everyone can view everyone's result and comment on those. And if you're in the developing industry, if you're a software developer and you have kind of the different stacks, I've also seen how the different teams kind of visualize that. So that's pretty cool. And I think actually I'm not gonna lie. Another thing which I'm just mentioning now for developers is Jira, and it's not the same as Miro, but it's the same company that does Trello. And this is something that lets you use the same coding environment. And this is something that then combats compatibility issues, because so sometimes when you develop an app, you said that sometimes you can like one person tests it out on the Android, another person tests it out on the Apple, and then it kind of doesn't work. But you can overcome this issue when you use Jira, where basically you can set the environment that you want to program in, and then it's the same. Another thing finally, which we've also looked at earlier, was VVox. There's also Mentimeter and Slido also. I've checked them out before. What I really like is this VWorks, which we've used earlier, because you can integrate it into PowerPoint, amazing. And you can use unlimited word clouds and questions, which the other ones can't do. But again, there's also a more premium version, which for academics is only six pounds as opposed to £10 for the other services. So it's not actually that bad. But with this, actually, you can kind of basically do what, like most of what you need to do that you can't actually get done with the other ones. And it also works without the app, which is amazing. Okay. I also wanted to quickly mention Kahoot, but more like as a social thing. It's basically this quiz platform. If you are kind of involved with the SU or so, you will have seen it because they use it so often for their SU quizzes. And that is also an amazing platform. But yeah, so let me finish off with the slide on what happens when everything breaks down. So unfortunately, probably maybe you've already kind of seen it happen in your teams. Sometimes performance just drops. Something is terribly, terribly wrong. What then happens is that you need to make it a discussion point. You can't just kind of sweep it under the floor under the carpet, because it will create this non-good feeling in the group and in the team and dynamic. And the best thing then to do is to schedule a meeting where everyone is invited to vent and to say what is fine and what needs to change. And also one idea to do this is to kind of say, oh, somebody is joining just when I was doing the last slide. Oh, cool. Okay, I'll just finish that off though. So one idea how you do this is basically to kind of say, okay, this is where we are now. This is how we want to do it. And then in the middle, kind of say what steps need to be taken to get there. Then it is important not to blame or ostracize anybody, but to kind of work together as a team, kind of say, okay, this is my team. I got to work with this now. And kind of then try to see what problems there are, how we can accommodate different needs, and really listen to the person, and then ask solution-oriented questions rather than kind of putting the blame game. And hypothetical questions look like this. You basically ask, yeah, what would help you to get this job done, or would it help you if we did that, or those are basically the two ones. And so to kind of find a solution that perhaps would fit them also, but don't go like, yeah, you're gonna do this now, and actually it doesn't actually work for this person. What's also really important is that you address the problem as soon as possible. At one point, maybe you're actually quite heated or so. Obviously, then first calm down a bit and then address it with some kind of somebody's text. Okay. When everyone, you should too. Christian is saying pro tip number four: when everything breaks down, you should too. Funny.
The old one, the good one.
So what were we though? But if it's just a small issue, don't go crazy, because that might actually make the situation worse. If you feel medium about it, then you're welcome to address it as soon as possible. But if you're really heated, then give it some time and then think about the thing logically before you create a nasty atmosphere in the group.
Can I chip in on that? Can I weigh in on that quickly, Juliet? On your point about like breaking down, and don't worry, it's not another witty remark. I was actually going to say what I've learned. I work with a couple of people, obviously in Essex startups. Some of them are like really good presenters, And one actual pro tip rather than a joke tip is, if something goes wrong, if you can hide it, you probably should hide it. Sometimes the audience won't even notice that something has gone down, that there's a technical error, that there's a technical issue. When you point it out and you show that you're nervous, you're just lowering your score. You're just, you know, like you're informing them that something has gone wrong. Where if you can sort of slide it past and you don't have to, like, for example, inform them and it's not obvious that there was a technical error, you probably shouldn't tell people. And a lot of people are tempted. Sometimes when something breaks down, when you take a bit longer to like put people into breakout sessions or anything like that, yeah. I feel like a lot of people panic and inform the audience. Don't do it. Just act like everything is going smoothly. And majority of the time, as long as it wasn't disastrous, you'll be fine and it will look better.
Yeah. But not always. So if it's like a medium issue that's kind of recurring also, for instance, if like somebody, I don't know, forgets like the little step, like we talked about the little steps earlier, if they kind of like don't go, the little steps that we kind of outlined but kind of just did something else and not did the step that they were supposed to, then we should definitely address that. So
I don't have a question, but I can share something. That this is my Trello, digital analog Trello, I don't know. So I use the post-its to move around the cards. So these are my cards. This is my 4 months, I think, till December. And I work on 80-20 principles. So only the 20% that gives you 80% of the value, only those are here. And so I put in my gym, everything, basically. And I try to do the most cognitively demanding things between nine. So my morning starts from 5 to 9. So I finish all my meditation workouts and everything. From 9 to 1, I do all the thinking. And 1 to 5, operational intensive, wherever I can. And then 5 to 7 is just tech-free.
How do you manage to stick to that routine?
I don't. But I try to get there. It's a progress. I fall back, I come back, and you'll never be stable. I used to feel guilty answering that question, but I don't. Because it's all about surfing the wave and it's fine.
Yeah. Because I was just gonna say, I can't. Whatever my poor attempts at creating a routine, I failed miserably. And yeah, that's cool. But you start your mornings at 5.
Yeah, and it's almost midnight here. So yeah, I'm like,
thank God.
I start my morning at 5 because the only way I can do that is to be doing what I absolutely love. So either I go for a run, I go somewhere outdoors. So I love to do that. So I can wake up anytime to do that. So I get that out of the way so that I can wake up anyhow. So I'll do anything to wake up in the morning so that I can sleep early, because I'll be shit tired anyway. So by evening. So I mean, that's another strategy, because my body is so tired that I'll fall asleep by 10.
Wow.
Yeah. I go for a second wind workout. I tire my body somehow. Yeah. If I'm not.
Are gyms still open in India?
Yeah, they are open. And if there are no gyms, I run on the road, take my car, go to a beautiful location, run there, come back, drive back.
I've stopped working out since the gym's closed here.
But thank you.
Yeah, no worries. Thank you for all of your insight.